War of words. And images. War of words. And images. War of words. And images. War of words. And images.
In 2003, a new word entered the English language, militainment. We now consume war in much the same way as we consume any other mode of entertainment. This has become a prominent feature of American life in the 21st century. The blending of war and pop culture is not necessarily a new phenomenon. What is new is the massive collaboration between the Pentagon and the entertainment industries. In addition, the scope of militainment has grown rapidly. The television war has now invaded popular culture on multiple fronts, including sports, toys, video games, film, reality TV, and more. How has war taken its place as a form of entertainment? The answer to this question has powerful implications for who we are and the world we inhabit. Join me now as we map the terrain of this new entertaining war. This is Militainment, Inc.
If TV ran the free world, TV doesn't run the world.
The country is about to go to war. The country's most popular basketball tournament is scheduled to begin, and the Academy Awards are scheduled for Sunday. So what will the organizers and the networks do? Here's ABC's Dean Reynolds.
Culturally, we've reached a place where war blends seamlessly into the broader entertainment landscape. So we gather to watch the war in the same way that we might gather to watch the Oscars or a large sporting event. In other words, we take it for granted that war is staged for our consumption.
ABC said if there are world events that warrant coverage on the night of the Academy Awards, ABC News will bring them to the American audience with the full support of the Academy.
Producers made that announcement today, but said developments in the war could still force a postponement.
Since war has become such a spectacular event, it is fitting that the 2003 invasion of Iraq began with a movie trailer produced by the Pentagon.
I do solemnly swear
to support and defend
the 4-minute film Enduring Freedom, the opening chapter, shown in movie theaters across the country in January of 2003. The executive would launch the invasion of Iraq just 2 months later.
I was once told by a commanding officer, it's not a question of if we go to combat, it's a question of when.
The trailer was an outgrowth of Hollywood's relationship with the Pentagon, which has been long-standing but was growing more overt at this time. For example, the 2001 film Behind Enemy Lines served as an explicit recruiting advertisement.
Down behind enemy lines.
When was the last time someone made a movie about what you do? Navy, accelerate your life. Log on to the Life Accelerator at Navy.com.
Behind Enemy Lines, available on video and DVD.
The real action, though, was not in the movie theater, but rather in the living room. TV news unleashed what amounted to be an unstoppable blitzkrieg of coming attractions.
Showdown Iraq.
It's time to roll tonight's Showdown Lowdown.
Here's your countdown rundown for tonight.
At this hour, American and coalition forces are in the early stages of military operations.
CNN Tonight.
News anchors juiced up their coverage with the kind of poetic language we might expect to hear in a movie trailer.
And this is a live shot of Baghdad as the dawn's early light begins to increase.
Air raid sirens, tracers, and anti-aircraft fire in the misty morning light signal a surprise air attack.
The calm, in a figurative sense, only before the storm.
Night sky in Baghdad.
As for those of us watching at home, we were addressed not as citizens, but as audience members at a big show.
Baghdad Live. We will keep a camera trained at all times on the night sky there. If that image changes, we will bring it to you immediately. As you see in night vision, a simple green and seemingly calm image for now.
Just taking again another look. You could sit and look at it by the hour, obviously waiting for something to happen at Baghdad.
Or perhaps we were watching a fireworks show at a picnic.
I'm watching, it looked like Roman candles going up into the night sky that stand on the desert sands.
Last night, a tremendous light show here, just a tremendous light show.
When Baghdad was lit up big time,
Baghdad, where another strike lit up the night just a short time.
This, of course, contained very little information value. The purpose was rather to keep us entertained, spellbound, and generally on the edge of our seats.
This was not the start of what some in the military call the big show, which is to say an overwhelming, awesome aerial campaign.
This was not the opening act of this war that any of us had been prepared for, that you had been listening to and about for many, many weeks.
That perhaps this is the quote-unquote shock and awe phase, the beginning of it in any event that we had all been waiting for.
I still very much believe from people I've talked to that we will all be shocked and awed at some point. People I talked to today said, look, what you're seeing now is just setting things up. When the massive assault starts, you will know it, there will be no doubt.
Shock and awe, the initial blitz of Baghdad, was only the first in a series of massive spectacles. The shock and awe strategy was invented by a man named Harlan Ullman for the National Defense University in 1996. Much like 9/11, the shock and awe strategy was a media event at its core, hence the camera emplacements all over the city. Shock and awe functioned to do a number of things. It psychologically overwhelmed the Iraqi military, it sent a message to the world about the superiority of U.S. military power, and it served as a weapons advertisement for the global arms trade. Finally, and perhaps most importantly, shock and awe put on a mesmerizing pyrotechnic show for those watching at home. It was a must-see TV event.
Finally, shock and awe.
First, though, some sights and sounds from the past week of Operation Iraqi Freedom.
That was real. Sounded like our troops have liberated a Yanni concert.
The Iraq War movie also came with a soundtrack. In some places, it was New Age music. Marching bands.
The Yanks are coming, the Yanks are coming, the drums rum tumming everywhere, so prepare.
Mostly the soundtrack came in the form of New Country.
Now, before the U.S. went to war in Iraq, country music star Darryl Worley, he came by the studio to remind us what we're fighting for in a tribute to those who died on September 11th. He performed his hit song, Have You Forgotten?
I hear people say, we don't need this war,
but I say there's something worth fighting for. What about our freedom?
So we got live performances on the news, music videos on the news.
It should be here and daily.
Thank you.
Music video channels like CMT hosted war-themed videos alongside pro-war messages.
It was a young man named Brian.
Some radio stations literally position themselves as soundtracks to the news.
You need us.
I make sure I watch the news every night, and I'm in tune to you guys every day, making sure I listen to everything.
The information you need. The music that inspires.
Just please remind everybody to fly those flags proudly.
96.5, The Mountain.
And you'll be sorry that you mess with the U.S. of A. We'll put a boot in your ass. It's the American way.
Toby Keith was crowned the king of the war movie soundtrack, casting the war as a barroom brawl. And he made sure to thank the producers of the movie in which his songs played.
I want to dedicate this great award to Mr. Rumsfeld and Tommy Franks.
Beyond Shock and Awe and Toby Keith's Shock and Y'all tour, the war featured a continual lineup of planned made-for-TV spectacles. The first of these was the rescue of Private Jessica Lynch.
Mike, today we heard more really heartrending details of the rescue of Private Jessica Lynch. We heard them from CENTCOM.
The Pentagon released its own night vision footage of the raid on Lynch's hospital room, complete with gunfire and soldiers kicking down doors. Later, it became clear that Lynch was in friendly hands and being well cared for at the hospital. Lynch herself told Diane Sawyer in an interview that she didn't know why the event was filmed and that it hurt her to know that the story had been largely fabricated. Regardless, 5 months later, Tom Brokaw opted to go with the Pentagon story over Lynch's for a Discovery Channel special.
The mission is a success. The 19-year-old supply clerk is the first American POW rescued from behind enemy lines since World War II.
The Lynch story is a good example of what media scholar George Gerbner has called instant history. Gerbner wrote after the first Gulf War that a boiling point is reached when the ability to wage war coincides with the ability to direct a movie about it. And indeed, we got the made-for-TV movie Saving Jessica Lynch just a few months after the event. But this was a natural decision for NBC as the script had already been penned by the Pentagon. This kind of movie making was not entirely new. If we look back to the first Gulf War, we find a made-for-TV film called The Heroes of Desert Storm, which was a joint production between ABC and the Pentagon.
Tonight's film is based on true stories and interweaves news footage and dramatizations with actors and actual participants. To achieve realism, no distinction is made among these elements.
Alongside scripted material and news footage, the film includes a welcome message from President Bush.
But the heroes of war are not just great leaders recorded by historians.
The film was the first of its kind, but it paved the way for future projects involving the mixing of public relations and dramatic filmmaking.
Look at that, would you? I pity the poor bastards down there.
That's why they call it war.
Here, with the help of Billy Baldwin, the dramatic motif was Top Gun.
There'll be thousands of sorties flown here. When they get through, Saddam's military will be in the gravel business, because that's all that'll be left of them, baby.
In 2003, the story was borrowed from another film, Steven Spielberg's Saving Private Ryan.
Team, that's it. That's it, boy.
That's her.
Bingo.
Jessica Lynch. We're United States soldiers and we're here to take you home.
Another fine example of the manufacture of instant history was the celebrated toppling of the Saddam statue in Baghdad's main square.
Back at the statue, they'd found a ladder and a rope. The people were determined to topple Saddam.
Tell me, will you bring this statue down?
A few hours later, they'd found a crane to do the job.
Here we had the appearance of a spontaneous act by throngs of liberated, ordinary Iraqis.
If this had been planned in some way, which manifestly it was not, that we can tell, it could hardly have been more effective, more powerful a message.
Now, we have seen a reluctance on the part of U.S. troops to help out these particular scenes, not giving the impression.
But we found out later in an Army report that the event had been staged by Army Psychological Operations. The report states, a Marine Corps colonel in the area saw the Saddam statue as a target of opportunity and decided that the statue must come down. The statue was then pulled down by a U.S. tank recovery vehicle. This was in every way a public relations event, designed to be broadcast as part of the Iraq War movie. And though virtually all networks went wall-to-wall with the toppling of the Saddam statue, they did little in the way of questioning the authenticity of the event.
Truth, with a capital T, is put in fine focus here like nowhere else.
That was a memorable day.
It was.
Did you watch all that?
I watched some of it. I had a guy hammering on it for a while, and I watched
it took a while to pull it down.
Well, I watched him hammer, and then they said they're hooking it up, and they've got the They got the crane out there.
Indeed, this was a masterful highlight of the war movie.
The goosebumps, if you don't have goosebumps now, you'll never get them in your life. Britt, please stand by. Somebody who you've spoken to quite a bit.
The idea of war as spectacle has become so naturalized in our culture that Mad Magazine could put out a very popular spoof movie poster. The tabloid show Inside Edition even decided to do a review of the Iraq War movie. The war practically had its own award show.
Thank you much for joining us tonight. I'm Paula Zahn.
The war was a win for Paula Zahn.
CNN's anchor Paula Zahn won the prize of anchoring prime time.
But we need to ask ourselves, whom did the war movie benefit? What does it mean for how we regard the most destructive human endeavor? And are we better or worse off as a democracy because of it?
It has been a horrendous day of terror with two huge and deadly attacks, suicide bombings in Iraq and Israel. And we caution you, some of the pictures in our coverage tonight that you are about to see are extremely graphic.
We found that
80%...
The new television war is occasionally punctuated by scenes of intense violence, when insurgent bombs target Westerners, for example.
There was chaos and unimaginable horror. Everywhere, torn bodies, blood-soaked survivors.
We have not quite yet become used to these sudden floods of violent imagery, but the scenes afford a unique glimpse into the face of human suffering, and we identify with that face. This is only one side of the TV war we have come to know, however. The other side of the war, the receiving end of Western bombs, has no face at all. This war without victims, without bodies, and without suffering is the war we have become used to. This war is easy to watch on the couch with a bag of chips. This war is, above all, clean. The clean war has been a long time in the making, extending back to Vietnam, the first television war. Late in the war, when domestic dissent became widespread, policymakers associated it with a free press, calling the phenomenon the Vietnam Syndrome. Thus began the search for sophisticated methods to control wartime imagery in order to placate the home front. After experimenting with various forms of media restriction in the 1980s, the Pentagon arrived at the perfect formula for the 1991 Gulf War. Create conditions by which war appears short, abstract, sanitized, and even aesthetically beautiful. Minimize any sense of death, of soldiers or civilians. When these factors converged, President George H.W. Bush proclaimed, "By God, we've kicked the Vietnam Syndrome once and for all." The first step in constructing the clean war is to dehumanize destruction by extracting all human imagery from target areas. The clean war prefers the view from above.
Well, from a distance, probably about 100 miles away, you can see just glowing clouds from the clouds over above Baghdad.
The airfield is simply a fuzzy image on his radar. From his virtually windowless workstation, he'll program precise global positioning coordinates into each of the 2,000-pound JDAM bombs.
Cameras on the ground in this clean war tend to tilt to the sky rather than to the street. Weapons are endlessly touted for their precision, their seeming inability to hurt civilians.
You'll pound them with 2,000-pound bombs and then go 2,000 in...
2,000-pound bombs in urban areas?
Oh, sure, absolutely.
Mankind has never seen anything like this, and the important thing is it's precision, Brett. That precision is designed to minimize the collateral damage.
And it was as precise as ever before in the history of warfare.
In the off chance that a civilian or two is killed, the clean war lets us know up front that it will be the fault of the enemy.
Where the Marines say the Iraqi government has been collecting and hiding leaflets dropped by the U.S.
telling civilians how to stay safe.
The U.S. Central Command says Iraq plans on having its paramilitary forces attack Iraqi citizens while wearing military uniforms identical to those worn by U.S. and British troops. Iraq will then blame coalition forces for the atrocities.
Iraqi forces in Basra open fire on their own people as they run for freedom.
No one is sure if it was U.S. guns or the Iraqi military shooting its own citizens.
And if innocents are killed, the survivors will understand.
U.S. Marines mistakenly kill a family of farmers, then lend a hand to bury them, and wind up with thanks from the survivors.
The language used to describe the clean war is as antiseptic as the pictures. Bombings are airstrikes. A future bombsite is a target of opportunity. Unarmed areas are soft targets. Civilians are collateral damage. Destruction is always surgical.
So you're going to have to go back and make another pass with some other asset to determine whether you've actually hit the target and what the impact is.
Well, you could throw in a lot of jargon in
there. I'm going to be careful.
A lot of jargon. We got assets and BDAs going.
But of course, the clean war can't escape certain contradictions, such as the fact that there is no such thing as a clean war.
On the second day, the plan calls for launching another 300 to 400 cruise missiles. There will not be a safe place in Baghdad, said one Pentagon official who has been briefed on the plan.
David, who is left in the capital of Iraq now?
Very few people have been able to get out. There have been very long queues at petrol stations.
It's almost a contradiction in terms of what we're being briefed, that it is going to be, we've been told for so many weeks and months, this massive aerial bombardment. But on the other hand, they also want to go soft for fear of doing too much damage to civilians and other kinds of infrastructure.
At this moment, the people there are never under attack, but the military forces there are not under attack either.
In the rare instance where civilians are acknowledged, the falling bombs are described as a minor annoyance.
The people of Baghdad are spending what must be a difficult and unsettling night, perhaps their last night before war begins. This is a live picture of Baghdad tonight, eerily quiet this evening.
One colonel with the 3rd Infantry sending a message to the Iraqi civilians. The message is this: stay home.
Well, it started out as a relatively quiet night last night in Baghdad, but this morning, Sunday morning, Iraqis are awakening to thunderous explosions.
Most rare is the humanizing of those on the ground. The image of civilians with families and fears is so out of place in the clean war as to seem surreal.
And I've never known this city so quiet. It's like everybody here is holding their breath, looking upwards, looking southwards, expecting the attack to come any minute now. There are many large civilian bomb shelters, but many people don't want to go in those. They all remember the casualties from the last Gulf War. They'd rather make it on their own, go in their own back gardens with their own children, and fend for themselves.
But by and large, the clean war wiped the humanity of civilians from the screen.
Baghdad is once again rocking under an aerial bombardment, which the Pentagon calls shock and awe. More explosions from what appeared.
The Pentagon publicly stated in 2003 that it does not do body counts. This leaves the task of counting to others. In November of 2004, the high-profile British medical journal, The Lancet, published a study conducted out of Johns Hopkins University. A group of epidemiologists used conventional sampling methods to estimate the civilian death toll. Making conservative assumptions, they wrote, we think that about 100,000 excess deaths or more have happened since the 2003 invasion of Iraq.
The U.S. loses more than 140 soldiers. At least 13 journalists die, including NBC's David Bloom. On the Iraqi side, the toll is in the thousands, but the exact number may never be known.
Though slightly more visible, images of U.S. dead are also scrubbed by the clean war. In 1991, President George H.W. Bush ordered a ban on press access to all returning U.S. caskets. A decade later, President George W. Bush strictly enforced the ban. Some of the few glimpses of the cost of war to U.S. families could only be seen in photos leaked to the Seattle Times. The U.S. military budget in 2005 approached the budgets of all other nations on Earth combined. In contrast, the Iraqi military budget was 1/400th of this size. What we call war has thus changed dramatically from the war of our grandparents, and it comes with a new language. The guiding metaphor by which we talk about this new clean-looking war is, not surprisingly, a cleanup job.
Would you categorize this as mop-up operations, or could there be some significant fighting as they go through these
towns? And the military says it's still mopping up small pockets of resistance in the town.
It's only a matter of time before the U.S. and coalition forces get the job done in Iraq.
We're a high altitude.
The pilot, who goes by the call sign Mr. Clean, simply flies the B-1 to an optimum release point for the JDAMs to begin their lethal glide.
And the clean war must contend with plenty of dirt.
They're planning to detonate a dirty bomb in the U.S.
It's the big fear, they might fight dirty.
But they're raiding the home of the notorious woman known as Dr. Germ.
Secretary of State Colin Powell called the fugitive dictator, and I quote, a piece of trash waiting to be collected by U.S. forces hunting him.
Also, another powerful metaphor that accompanies the clean war is that of the hunt.
Even to the degree of chasing one ghostly figure running down the road.
He went down to the ground.
Yeah, he just dove on the ground. He's
okay,
moving again.
One Taliban escaped by heading to a mosque.
We can get a good sense of the hunting metaphor at work by looking at the way Fox News treated some footage released by the Pentagon during the Afghan invasion of 2001. The footage came from an AC-130 gunship, nicknamed Azrael for the Angel of Death in the Quran.
The hunt intensifies.
Even though the glowing figures on the ground were human beings, the effect of the narrative is akin to, say, someone zapping insects.
The gunship finishes up the job.
Ready. Back on the other guys.
All right, get the other guy.
One last look, and back to base.
Like the cleanup job, the hunting metaphor casts the business of killing humans into something more palatable. Abstracting the war into a hunt for a few game animals gives us a very selective view of what's at stake. But it does make war TV friendly.
Good morning. Stepping up the hunt for Saddam Hussein.
I don't know how close we are to getting Saddam Hussein. You know, it's closer than we were yesterday, I guess. All I know is we're on the hunt.
That U.S. forces hunting for Saddam Hussein have new leads
and will be hunted down and treated with accordingly.
We're still hoping to hunt them down as you are looking at tanks rolling their way through Baghdad.
The clean war so dominates the screen that we actually have to be reminded that when bombs fall, people die. After all, there's a small chance that we may be exposed to images of human suffering that slip through the cracks. If this were to happen, and we didn't have warnings like this one from Dan Rather, we might not know what to think.
That the leadership of the United States feels very important for people to understand, and that is, quote, Americans ought to be prepared for loss of life, which is to say, must be prepared for loss of life, loss of the lives of our own fighting men and women, as well as those of the British and Australians who are gathering us, and the loss of life inside Iraq. Does it need to be said?
Strangely, it does.
You're looking at some of the B-1 bombers that haven't been deployed from Ellsworth Air Force Base yet, but this morning around 4 a.m. local time, the first three took off, and when you're 300 feet away from them when they do it, you hear it in your shoes and feel it in your gut.
In the time leading up to the 2003 invasion of Iraq, MSNBC's John Elliott had a job to do. His task was to lead us around a virtual showroom of military hardware. Mr. Elliott's enthusiasm for his job was unmistakable. He was a kid in a candy store.
Affect the way the plane flies. Just imagine 7 of these used just for the...
I want to walk you here from the ground first. This is the Boxer. This is an amphibious assault ship. You see the crew members lining up there. These are the Sea Knights here. These are the transport helicopters.
The message was clear enough. The proper attitude to take toward these machines of destruction was not somberness, but delight.
And another base here in San Diego, Miramar, you hear those things buzzing overhead quite a bit. Big monsters there. Also have some aerial views. As I mentioned, this deployment...
Elliot, of course, wasn't the only one. Together, the networks dispatched a choir of reporters to sing the praises of the high-tech war machine.
The U.S. appears to have assembled now an awesome display of missiles within striking range. Fox News Pentagon correspondent Brett Baer has that story.
4th Infantry today is the world's deadliest, most technologically advanced armored division. And it's arriving in Kuwait as part of Task Force Iron Horse, a mighty second wave of American power about to break on Iraq.
These 27-ton machines, that's roughly the weight of 4 elephants, can pound over flat terrain at nearly 50 miles an hour, delivering infantry close to their objectives while shielding them from hostile fire. Plus, they can swim.
They're bringing in, yeah. I got to tell you, my favorite aircraft, the A-10 Warthog. I love the Warthogs. They're in.
Very interesting thing I might want to point here out on the F-18. You might be able to pick it out, and that is the Bunker Busters. A lot of talk about the weaponry used in this conflict with Iraq.
The networks also deployed an endless caravan of animated stat sheets for various weapon systems. Weapons became central characters in the drama, and the Iraq War movie featured a cast of dozens. In the near total absence of meaningful debate regarding the wisdom of military invasion, we were inundated with meaningless trivia regarding the weapons of the invasion.
Which U.S. battle group on patrol in the Persian Gulf is now stationed closest to Iraq? Is it A, the USS Abraham Lincoln, B, the USS Constellation, or C, the USS Harry Truman? The answer coming up on the Showdown Lowdown.
This obsession with the weapons of war has a name, techno-fetishism. Weapons appear to take on a magical aura. They become centerpieces in a cult of worship.
The test is of the newest, biggest, baddest U.S. bomb.
Now, this is the first live test of a MOAB, and we expect to get video of this test up here at the Pentagon sometime today.
When the Pentagon showcased the largest conventional bomb in its arsenal, the MOAB, the networks went wall to wall with rituals of devotion.
And we have been told they will try and release some pictures to us.
The MOAB carries 18,000 pounds of high explosives, and on impact creates a 10,000-foot high mushroom-like cloud that looks and feels like a nuclear weapon.
Apart from gazing at the majesty of these bombs, we are also invited to step inside these high-tech machines and take them for a spin. Thanks to anchors like Lester Holt, for example, we were able to ride inside a B-1 bomber.
I was on a simulated bombing mission in a B-1 several months ago. The bombardier, no windows, in the dark, never sees the ground, simply putting in coordinates.
And we even find ourselves in the cockpit.
But over Iraq, the B-1s will likely be operating much higher as they were during this simulated bombing mission MSNBC flew on last fall over Texas.
And also aboard the B-2 bomber. Perhaps we were as giddy as anchor Greta Van Susteren to try our hands at the controls.
How do you steer this thing? You have a stick, is that right?
Sure. We have both of us have matching center stick with left throttles. You can do everything from that side of the cockpit that I can do from this side of the cockpit. And
President Bush acted out this wish in 2003 as part of a photo opportunity. Daydreaming about riding in a fighter plane thus became an official national pastime.
The president chose to fly in on a Navy jet because he wanted to experience landing on a carrier short deck and the adrenaline rush that comes with it.
He was like catching his breath. He was just like, wow. And, you know, he had to take a little time to pause for a second.
He'd hoped to be in one of the sexier fighter jets, but that idea was grounded by the Secret Service. That wasn't the end of the president's experience on the flight deck. He was also treated to the teeth-rattling power of the F-18s as they rocketed off the Lincoln on their final mission.
If we don't have a president or a news anchor handy, sometimes we just hitch a ride. Or if we have the means, we can purchase one of the military vehicles on the consumer market. Not only are we invited to fantasize about being in the driver's seat, we are routinely invited to peer through the crosshairs, too. These repeated modes of imaging war cultivate new patterns of perception, new relationships to the tools of state violence. In other words, we become accustomed to seeing through the machines of war.
Byron's report was taped using a special night scope lens.
These modes of seeing position us not as third-party observers, but rather as woven into the apparatus of battle.
The fully digitized M1A2 tanks. If the enemy stays together...
Apart from ritualistic worship, the fetishizing of weapons demands that they be depicted as objects of beauty. The romance of the still photograph will do the trick. Weapons sometimes take on sexual symbolism. Weapons are often shot in silhouette against a sunset. These techniques can be found in a number of places, such as military recruiting ads, in music videos on the war movie soundtrack. Movies like Saving Jessica Lynch or The Heroes of Desert Storm are chock full of sunsets. We don't have to look far on the news for a caption to these images.
The forces on the front facing what's left of Iraq's armed services may soon see those Buffalo soldiers and the rest of Task Force Iron Horse galloping over the horizon, riding 500 heavy tanks and other armored equipment. That's it for Kuwait City. Back to you.
It's going to be a sight for sore eyes. Geraldo Rivera from Kuwait. Geraldo, thanks very much.
The final aspect of weapons fetishism ascribes an inherent moral goodness to technology. An act of destruction is regarded as more righteous if caused by high-tech weapons as opposed to low-tech.
Swift. Surgical. Powerful. More accurate weapons. More advanced technology.
The story of the inherent virtue of high-tech weaponry is often told through the language of civilization versus barbarism. High-tech weapons are often used as evidence of the moral superiority of the nations that wield them.
That our technology is advanced to the point where we can pinpoint where Saddam Hussein is.
They better not mess with the United States of America, and they better not mess with civilized countries, because we are going to defend ourselves, and we are going to stand up for civilization against these barbarians.
If this aspect of techno-fetishism is to make sense, it must be accompanied by a constant reminder of the disparity between high-tech and low-tech.
A combination of skills, ranging from diplomacy to high-tech combat, enable them to operate amidst an ancient culture.
And through its narrow valleys.
You can fly over places that look like the Stone Age.
With a faithful weapon, the Cobra helicopter.
One can only see through a night vision lens. Technology believed to be in short supply in the Iraqi army.
More evidence of the huge technological gap that has developed between the U.S. and Iraq since Operation Desert Storm.
So this time around, it was literally almost a no contest.
Iraqis are taking on American troops, sometimes armed with nothing more than a flintlock rifle. They take on tanks with their sedans.
This disparity is even represented graphically. The low-tech side of the war equation is often rendered in a jagged typewriter font. High-tech weapons often blend with national symbols.
And to think, somewhere, some poor guy is buying a minivan.
Navy, accelerate your life.
In 2001, military recruiters began to make the appeal to techno-fetishism a major part of their recruitment campaigns.
Why should you consider getting an education in the Navy? This is one of your classrooms. Because rocket science is more fun when you actually have rockets. Navy, accelerate your life.
You ever been around anything this fast before?
Yeah, in my last job.
It's the most powerful weapon system ever invented. It's called Aegis, and it's just one of the amazing technologies you'll find only in the United States Navy. Navy, accelerate your life.
TV news and recruitment ads seem to be borrowing from the same set of images. This is significant. It tells us that the two are essentially telling the same story.
There's a saying in the military, train like you fight, fight like you train. A mantra American air crews have faith will keep them alive and help them get the job done as America once again goes to war.
He is the ace of spades in the playing cards of the regime's most wanted members. His whereabouts are the subject of speculation and wild rumor.
In order for the Iraq War movie to be properly dramatic, it needed to construct a proper villain. Saddam Hussein, with his well-known record of dictatorial rule and mass murder, made this an easy task. But the picture of Hussein drawn by the dominant news media was highly selective. One crucial fact remained invisible. During the 1980s, the period of his worst human rights violations, Hussein was a close U.S. ally. Billions of dollars of U.S. military aid helped keep Hussein's minority Ba'athist party in power. This fact was obvious to many Iraqi immigrants living in the United States, but it was part of the story left out for American audiences.
Saddam is not our president. Saddam is an agent of the West. So the people who brought him in power, it's about time to clean their mess and get him out.
I thank you very much for your time. Gentlemen, thank you so much.
In 1990, Hussein disobeyed his American benefactors and invaded Kuwait. Thus began the long-term effort to replace him, perhaps with somebody as useful as the old Hussein. In a rare instance of historical reflection, Peter Jennings reminisced about this radical shift.
From ally to enemy, an astonishing American relationship with Saddam Hussein over the last 20 years. It astonishes people who follow the region all these years of how the United States' relationship with him has changed in so many ways, and it will be a long and deeply integral part of the history that is written about this campaign.
But this important fact was notably absent in the lead-up to the 2003 overthrow of the Iraqi government.
I think that to in any way be defending a torturer, a killer, a dictator who used chemical weapons against his own people is pretty remarkable, but it's a very long tradition in the Democratic Party.
If Hussein's crimes were to be used against him, U.S. support for him during this period would have to be forgotten. This allowed the symbolic process known as demonization to begin in full. The first step in this process was the reduction of the war to a conflict between one good guy and one bad guy. This was often accomplished graphically by facing off photos of Presidents Bush and Hussein.
Mr. Bush set a one-day deadline.
He can either get rid of his weapons or the United States will disarm this man.
Showdown Iraq.
Do you use one bullet? Do you use a tank? Do you use an airplane?
The contest had all the intrigue and trash talk of a grade school playground.
This is not new rhetoric for him. I remember it vividly from 1991. He couldn't do it then. Can he do it now?
To you, what do you think of Saddam's statements? We won the war. That's a lot of chutzpah, isn't it?
It sure is.
Also, a string of insults from Iraq's foreign minister, Naji Sabri, directed at President Bush and Prime Minister Blair. He called them warmongers, war criminals, cowboys, idiots.
I mean, are you surprised that he's still here? He's still giving us a hard time in 2003?
As the invasion approached, the sense of a duel between one black hat and one white hat intensified.
Tonight, the American people will know Saddam Hussein has committed his final act of defiance.
Countdown to war right now. Saddam Hussein running out of time to meet President Bush's deadline to step down.
We are now 24 to 48 hours away from the start of the final battle with Saddam Hussein.
And begin the showdown with Saddam.
The President of the United States did indeed speak last night. He said Saddam Hussein and his sons have 48 hours to get out of town, and if they don't, we're going to take them down and take down the regime.
Rick, with the president essentially giving Saddam 48 hours to get out of Dodge, war now seems all but inevitable.
Before the deadline for Mr. Saddam Hussein to get out of Dodge.
Convoy of unidentified diplomats apparently getting out of Dodge from Studio B. Let's go to Steve Harrigan.
One editorial cartoon captured this dominant framing of the war as an OK Corral shootout. The metaphor of the duel has a cost, however. This repeated framing directs our attention away from those who will be caught in the crossfire, the lives of soldiers, civilians, and future generations. Reducing the conflict to two characters limits our ability to imagine the consequences of war. The process of demonization went far beyond separating good characters from bad. Anchors consistently compared Hussein to Hitler, an indisputable evil figure.
That the two countries who stood shoulder to shoulder against Hitler 50 years ago are united today in their fight to disarm Saddam Hussein.
Absolutely. There's a lot of talk that it should be de-bathified Germany was denazified after World War II country.
Now, one State Department official told me that what is most concerning to the Bush administration is that they do not want Syria to become the way Algeria was, sort of a safe haven for Nazi war criminals after World War II.
What I'm thinking about here is, in 1944, a group of brave soldiers, German soldiers, tried to take out Hitler. He was severely damaged. Prussian ethic kept their top generals, the Manstein generals, from rebelling when we all thought they would have. What is the ethic that keeps the Republican Guard staying with this guy if he's injured? There is no Iraqi war ethic.
Thanks, Natalie. Instant history now for April 10th, and if you want a hopeful context for our countdown flashback, it was 42 years ago today that the war crimes trial started for the Nazi Adolf Eichmann, and 57 years ago today that the first election was conducted for the new Japanese parliament.
Though the U.S. military dwarfed the Iraqi military by a factor of 400, World War II somehow became the dominant analogy, with its language of Allied and Axis powers.
Blair say Allied forces will achieve victory over Saddam Hussein in what the president calls a noble purpose.
Well, there are reports, at least, that the Allied forces have taken some degree of control of that city.
That we shall pay any price, bear any burden.
The Cold War analogy came in at a close second, as in this jingoistic bumper featuring John F. Kennedy, aired on MSNBC. Anchors routinely compared Iraq to the massive Soviet empire.
This is the place where you've seen those pictures of Saddam Hussein constantly firing off pistols. Every time you see that, that is shot right here. That's kind of the Lenin Square, the top of Lenin's tomb, I should say, the Kremlin, if you will, for Saddam Hussein, and that's where those parades occur. Anyway, those are possible.
This analogy was most fully realized in the spectacular felling of the Saddam statue.
A couple of observations, though. This does really remind you, with you saw those guy, the guy with a sledgehammer pounding at the base of that statue, of the day the Berlin Wall came down.
A moment not unlike that of the fall of the Soviet Union, when we saw statues coming down in Eastern Europe and indeed in the heart of the Soviet Union.
And, Chris, I'm guessing that once this statue goes down, a lot of those Iraqi people are going to be trying to get a piece of that statue, just as so many people tried to get a piece of history and getting a piece of the Berlin Wall back in 1989. Again,
the Battle of Iraq is one victory in a war on terror that began on September the 11th, 2001. The liberation of Iraq is a crucial advance in the campaign against terror. We've removed an ally of Al-Qaeda.
The networks also took a cue from the Bush administration and wove Iraq into the narrative of terrorism.
Suspects, according to the U.S. military, with ties to Saddam's old regime and Al-Qaeda.
The war on terror and Operation Iraqi Freedom occupied the same screen.
Jeff, by the way, one of the things that the Marines have done so remarkably well is to target these locations that were key installations for terrorism. This is the headquarters of one of the Saddam Fedayeen units. It's a training center for terrorists.
They found a terrorist bomb-making facility in southern Baghdad.
The Fedayeen Saddam are the terrorists, as Secretary Donald Rumsfeld called them, who work loosely with, as the secretary puts it, Saddam Hussein, and have been
these terrorists, Fedayeen Saddams.
Thus, Iraq and Al Qaeda merged into one. This presented a problem for embedded reporter Jim Axelrod as he stood befuddled by a painting of the New York City skyline in a bombed-out Iraqi barbershop.
But it's not a trophy painting of the destroyed towers. It's more like some glorification of them.
It's certainly bizarre. That's the only word that can come up.
But that's not the only challenge to logic in Kefal.
There was one challenge to logic back in the U.S., however. In August of 2004, a full 70% of the U.S. population believed that Iraq had a part in carrying out the 9/11 attacks,
that there was no connection between Iraq and Al Qaeda.
Still in 2006, 85% of U.S. troops serving in Iraq believed their mission was in retaliation for Saddam's role in 9/11. It remains a mystery as to where the troops and the majority of the U.S. population received this erroneous information.
The reason I keep insisting that there was a relationship between Iraq and Saddam and Al Qaeda, because there was a relationship between Iraq and Al Qaeda.
The terrorists attacked us and killed 3,000 of our citizens before we started the freedom agenda in the Middle East. What did Iraq have to do with what?
The attack on the World Trade Center.
Nothing. Nobody's ever suggested that the attacks of September the 11th were ordered by Iraq.
When the familiar stories of political evil had been activated, the Iraq War movie went to work on a more personal level. Particularly, Saddam Hussein's sexual deviance became an object of obsessive focus. He was depicted as a cross-dresser, a sadomasochist, and generally a man who derived sexual pleasure from violence. Among human rights organizations back into the 1980s, Hussein and his sons did have a reputation for excess and brutality, but the process of demonization demanded that these attributes become a sudden object of intense interest.
The young prince and brutal playboy, Uday Hussein. Now, we got in yesterday. Let me show you this place. Unbelievable. Something out of Beverly Hills or Block Island. The taste, equally as bad as that mansion, is large, including a large warehouse, a gym, a home for prostitutes, and a zoo. Dozens of bedrooms. Closets bigger than most homes and elaborate furnishings, beveled mirrors, the finest bone china, a racquetball court.
Imperial megalomania. God knows how much money this place cost.
In his leisure time, Saddam Hussein and his cronies would retreat to a floating palace on the Tigris. This is how his personal yacht used to look, a sumptuous vessel fitted in exotic woods, marble, silver, and gold. And this is how the $50 million vessel looks today. Saddam's son Uday would fly his helicopter to the teak landing pad and hold wild orgies on board.
While most Iraqis suffered in poverty, the 39-year-old Uday lived a life of fast cars, expensive liquor, and easy women. His bedroom looked like part of the Playboy mansion.
As apparent justification for the invasion, we are treated to a veritable laundry list of questionable personal items found in the Hussein palaces.
Hundreds of videos, we found bottles of Cuervo 1800 tequila, vodka, cognac, Corona and Miller beers, Dom Perignon, 40-year-old French wines, expensive brandy, plenty of whiskey, boxes and boxes of Cuban cigars with his own name on them. Now, we also were told that they found 6 bags of heroin, boxes of pills, medicines everywhere, including some labeled ginseng sexual fortifiers, heartburn medication, Prozac, and an AIDS screening kits. Uday's obsession with sex was evident everywhere. Paintings of naked women, bundles of internet printouts of what appeared to be prostitutes, complete with handwritten ratings on each, a black book listing hundreds of women's names and phone numbers, plenty of photos of Uday's upscale lifestyle, mixed in with boxes from UNICEF meant for school children.
Wow. I mean, not to say that they were using it, but drunk on all of that, smoking the cigars, shooting up heroin, popping pills. I mean, how did they have time to be such brutal dictators?
Because the war was reduced to a feud between the houses of Bush and Hussein, we were led to believe that Uday's obsession with drugs, violence, and sex might have even threatened the first family.
One strange find, pictures of President Bush's twin daughters discovered in a gymnasium.
The endless talk of deviance, hedonism, and Babylon also seemed to take on biblical proportions. In resonance with the famously wicked city destroyed by God in the Hebrew Bible, Saddam became Sodom.
And Saddam Hussein giving his generals their marching orders.
He bluntly rejected President Bush's ultimatum that Saddam leave Iraq with his two sons.
Death of Saddam Hussein.
The deadline for Saddam, less than 3 hours away.
Do you think there's a possibility that we did wound Saddam?
That whole Saddam thing was very odd.
The leadership, specifically Saddam.
Complete end to what someone today described as Saddamism. I like that.
One of the pleasures of the Iraq War movie then was to witness a decadent Hussein family go from riches to rags, their precious yacht and palace in ruins.
Uday's whereabouts, like his father's, are unknown. But somewhere he may be being tortured himself by these images. Troops toasting victory at the wet bar where he once entertained beautiful women. And a U.S. infantry woman, Felicia Harris, resting on Uday's bed.
When U.S. troops finally did capture Hussein, animal metaphors dominated the Iraq War movie. Hussein was pulled from a spider hole. Cartoonists portrayed him as a rat, as vermin flushed from hiding. The narrative was clear. The clean war was getting the job done. But in the history of depicting the enemy, this was nothing new. Racial stereotypes are common. The enemy is often portrayed as a sex fiend, perhaps the type to make off with the president's daughters. The enemy is also depicted through metaphors of the lowliest animals. A more recent continuation of these patterns occurred in 1989, when President George Bush Sr. made the decision to sponsor Operation Just Cause, a U.S. overthrow of the government of Panama. This time, the villain was Manuel Noriega. In an episode strikingly similar to Hussein's, Noriega had been an ally right up to the overthrow. He was even on the CIA payroll, and perhaps was the most famous of the U.S.-sponsored dictators trained at the School of the Americas in Fort Benning, Georgia. But like Hussein, when he defied the wishes of his benefactors, these powers moved to replace him, killing thousands of civilians in the process. When Noriega was finally captured, the Pentagon released a video of his office. Among other items, they purportedly found a voodoo altar with buckets of blood, pornography, kilos of cocaine, and a copy of Hitler's Mein Kampf.
There is, we understand, a certain Groundhog Day quality about all of this.
Rather than asking whether these objects are authentic, we should ask why they suddenly take center stage. Why the singular fascination with the personal lives of these leaders, even to the exclusion of more relevant debates about the wisdom of military action. The answer to this question may lie in patterns of demonization. Patterns that make the Iraq War movie look like one scene in a much longer epic.
Now some 500 reporters have been embedded, as the Pentagon says, with U.S. and allied forces. They will be able to broadcast live from the battlefield.
The embedded press system engineered for the 2003 invasion of Iraq dramatically changed the relationship between home front and battlefield.
Vietnam was the first war Americans watched in their living rooms, but this time, they'll be watching war live. What will they make of it?
This was a big change from the Gulf War of 1991. Instead of corralling reporters into press pools and tent cities, the executive sent individual reporters through a kind of boot camp and assigned them units.
I was a little skeptical at first about the whole embedding concept,
it really has worked out just as advertised. We're getting to see a lot of stuff, as you saw before.
It's truly history in the making with the military and media cooperation unprecedented in the history of war on this planet. And we're getting some...
The embedding scheme, of course, prompted new questions.
None of us wants to turn war into entertainment. But in an instantaneous 24-hour media-saturated world, I'm not sure that this is worse than being shut out of the battlefield.
These concerns were not unfounded. As the war progressed, it seemed to take on the look and feel of reality TV. In fact, the embedding idea sprang directly from a 2002 experiment in reality TV called Profiles from the Front Line. Working with the Defense Department and the Pentagon, ABC enlisted the creative talent of two men, the king of action movies, Jerry Bruckheimer, and the father of reality TV, Bertram Van Munster. Together they produced Profiles. The show, like a cross between Cops and Black Hawk Down, featured cameras that followed soldiers in Afghanistan.
Alpha 1, this is space, over.
An average day in Afghanistan, somebody will know where some Al-Qaeda are. The helicopters will crash in your compound.
He's gonna end up being flown out of here to another location in country. At that location, they have professional interrogation teams.
I'm bringing the dog down here right now.
Get out, boy.
That is now the property of Governor Tannenwald.
At night, our box gets a lot smaller, and our margin for error...
Secretary of Defense Donald Rumsfeld was so enthusiastic about the success of Profiles that he and Vice President Cheney made it the model by which the embedded reporting system was later designed. Profiles aired from February to March of 2003 as the buildup to the invasion of Iraq reached a fever pitch. But by the time Profiles aired, the American public was already well used to the militarization of reality TV. Even before September 11th, 2001, in March, the Navy was making deals with MTV for its Real World Road Rules Extreme Challenge, where teams suited up in Navy garb to compete in emergency submarine drills. Later that year, the regular Road Rules show struck a similar deal with the Air Force.
Oh, yeah! Oh,
it's a B-2 stealth bomber. No civilians ever see this, just Air Force personnel, and nobody gets that close to it.
MTV got a cheap, exciting show, and the Air Force got access to its most valuable demographic.
We have a message that just came in for the crew of Road Rules. The message states...
Also in March 2001, TBS Superstation piloted a competition between teams of real soldiers called War Games. Football star Howie Long did the play-by-play. Ann Powell, daughter of then-Secretary of State Colin Powell, provided commentary. On the very same day, Fox kicked off its reality show, Boot Camp.
Premise is simple. For the first 7 weeks, 8 men and 8 women, all called recruits, go through rigorous U.S. Marine boot camp training.
There were 16 contestants that are in boot camp for 2 months. They are put to the test. They grueling challenges, getting up early, being in basically in the military. And each episode, one person is voted off. After the person is voted off, he or she picks another person off the show.
You might notice that boot camp resembles the hit show Survivor. CBS thought so too and sued Fox. Apart from Survivor, though, Boot Camp seemingly took its cues from the newly launched Army of One recruitment campaign, which also featured a reality TV-style series of webisodes about recruits in basic training. Both essentially had the same plot. Both employed a similar aesthetic, even some of the same graphics. It was difficult to tell the two apart, but perhaps this was the point.
Only at GoArmy.com.
In fact, Boot Camp was a cooperative venture between Fox and the Marine Corps. Captain Sean Haney, director of the Marine Corps Entertainment Liaison Office in Los Angeles, stated, "Right now, reality TV is the big thing. We are the first service to step into the survival reality shows. We looked at it as an opportunity to give the public a glimpse into the Marine Corps." Not to be outdone, the creator of Survivor, Mark Burnett, produced a show for the USA Network called Combat Mission.
And I brought in some of the best feature film people to help me make it look great. I brought in my pyrotechnics people who just came off Pearl Harbor and wintered with John Woo. I brought in my military advisors who were also on Pearl Harbor. The guys from traffic did all my helicopter stunts and aerials. The results are pretty spectacular.
But combat missions also contained a grim lesson. Burnett's first pick for a contestant was a former Navy SEAL named Scott Helvenston, who soon became a favorite on the show. Only a year after combat missions aired, Helvenston again appeared on television, this time in Iraq. Iraqi resistance ambushed an SUV in Fallujah, killing all four people inside, including Helvenston. The insurgents videotaped the event and distributed the footage. Virtually without exception, the news referred to the dead as civilian contractors. In fact, they were mercenary soldiers working for a private company called Blackwater USA, one of many such contractors that the Pentagon now uses in place of government soldiers. Pictures of the crowd dragging the charred bodies through the streets of Fallujah became some of the more defining images of the war. Helvenston's story, while tragic, draws into sharp focus the line between reality and reality TV. The Air Force decided that it wanted a piece of the reality TV pie too. Its entertainment liaison office commandeered the help of an old friend, Tony Scott, who had directed Top Gun, a movie that turned out to be one of the biggest recruiting successes in the history of military Hollywood collaboration. Along with director Ridley Scott, they produced American Fighter Pilot for CBS.
Maverick's airborne.
Three men, 110 days, one will be Top Gun.
The show began airing in March of 2002. The producers decided that the powerful imagery of 9/11 and the rhetoric of the war on terror ought to be woven into the show's teaser.
We're the brightest beacon for freedom and opportunity in the world, and no one will keep that light from shining.
Our country is strong. A great people has been moved to defend a great nation.
Other military reality shows aired in the summer of 2002, including VH1's Military Diaries, where armed service personnel kept video journals of their days. Perhaps one of these shows inspired the idea for ABC's Profiles from the Front Line, which began shooting around this time. Recall that Profiles was the prototype for the embedded reporting system. The show began its run in early 2003. As the invasion approached, however, ABC canceled Profiles, presumably to make way for the big reality TV war.
We are seeing this battle unlike any war we've ever been able to witness, almost instantaneous, some is very dramatic. We've got some footage from the Department of Defense of the U.S. Army Rangers in a battle that raged last night. Let's look and listen.
What characterized embedded reporting first and foremost was its privileging of experience over understanding.
We had very little perspective on what was happening at home and the other pieces of the puzzle. We could follow our unit closely, but we didn't have much connectivity with the outside world.
Just experiencing the sights, sounds, and smells of the scene became the objective.
Give us a feel for the latest, Greg, and also can you give us a feel for, is there a smell in the air? Is there a pace that's quickening? Give us a feel for what it's like to be in the middle of all that.
It's on a personal level of what that was like. What did you see? What did you hear? What did you feel?
And we had one incoming a short time ago, and then another one just moments ago that I could feel. You know, earlier we watched bombs fall on southern Iraq and felt the concussion. They were 2,000-pound bombs, JDAMs, and they lit up the sky.
Only the most superficial information seemed to survive in this new environment.
All right, I apologize. As you can imagine, it's really hard to hear you and even hear myself here on the flight line. The F-14 that you just saw take off I'm not going to give you full names at this point. I'm going to stick with call signs. That was Crunchy and Rico taking off in that jet. Prior to that, it was Tonto and Sully.
Go out. They are obviously firing at Iraq into the border region. Ah! They're firing 96-pound high-explosive artillery shells.
If Vietnam was the first living room war, Iraq in 2003 was the final collapse of the distinction between home front and battlefield.
They are out of the 3rd Infantry Division. Whoa! I gotta tell you, it's a rather surreal experience watching these things go off as close as we are.
The embedding system also featured a compulsion to equate reporters with soldiers. This was done in a number of ways. Many news organizations simply opted to use the word "we" in place of "the military."
How would a war with Iraq actually unfold? What targets might we attack first? Which divisions would be the first to fire?
So if we decide to attack Iraq again, what will be different this time around?
Well, that raises a good question. Now that we are trumpeting our location,
absolutely,
and we're announcing where we are, what does that mean? Have we opened ourselves up to any possible
Instead of a check on power, a fourth estate, the media took their role to be what General Tommy Franks described as the fourth front, an extension of military power. Domestic public opinion thus entered the sphere of battle. If the press was now a useful weapon, objective journalism was the first casualty.
Brian, we're on a security mission of sorts once again, this time on the lookout for Iraqi tanks and armored vehicles that are still lurking east of Baghdad. We killed 3 tanks yesterday.
Back in the studio, even anchors adopted military language.
Britt Hume live with us in Washington. Britt's going to stand down for a little while, do some reporting of his own, and he'll be back.
By its very structure, the embedding system seemed to prompt a new way of speaking about journalism.
Mike Saray reporting with the 1st Marines in Iraq. He's been with them from California, traveled overseas with them, and very deeply embedded in a personal way with the Marines that he's traveling with.
But Shepard Smith of Fox News probably put it most succinctly.
We have a number of correspondents embedded with our troops across the region, some in Kuwait, some in...
So long as reporters were now in bed with the military instead of just covering it, they might as well be fitted not only with microphones, but with tanks too.
Why don't you take a walk over and talk to Baghdad Bob and see if he wants to admit that... Or bring a tank with you and introduce Baghdad Bob to the great tank guys, number 3.
There were a few rare moments of self-reflection regarding this new relationship with the military.
CNN's Jason Bellini is embedded with a Marine unit, and he was also involved in the effort, or he was involved in covering the effort. Let's not mistake anybody's roles here.
But it was the embedded reporter from CBN and Pat Robertson's 700 Club who made no bones about his abandonment of journalistic ethics. Of course, he was in the service of a higher power.
And I got out of the Humvee, and I looked up at the night sky over Baghdad. There was tracer fire everywhere, bombs going off like crazy, and the Lord said, celebrate the victory in the midst of the battle right now. So I began to praise the Lord, and I began to shout out, Jesus is Lord of Iraq. And it's like the Lord just gave me this tremendous peace and joyfulness, and he said, you have done it. The mission is done. Jesus is Lord of Iraq.
Jesus is Lord of Iraq.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. It's hard to know whether Jesus would have been as excited as Paul Strand about the falling bombs. What we do know is that had Jesus been embedded in this war, he would have been punished for expressing anything but unquestioning loyalty to the powers that be.
News today, NBC News fired journalist Peter Arnett this morning for participating in an interview on Iraqi state-controlled television.
The first war plan has failed because of Iraqi resistance. Now they're trying to write another war plan.
The embedding system had sold itself on unfettered access to the battlefield. As it turns out, this was another way of saying that the leash had been shortened.
It's really sort of night and day if you compare even what we know now, think about what we still don't know about military actions in Afghanistan,
yes,
with, for instance, what happened in Vietnam. And I'm sure there are lots of folks at CNN who were there, friends of yours, Aaron, who will tell you instantly that the degree of access they had, the degree of freedom they had to go where they want to go, was infinitely greater than what's playing out here.
The rules had been set. Journalists who refused to play soldier were voted off the island. For the rest of them, the central plot of this reality show was clear. They were in the army now. Would they cut it?
If it does come down to military action, then this is the one that we've been assigned to ride in. It is number B204. Important to remember that number, they say, because there could be so many of them out there. Well, you wouldn't want to get on the wrong one. Let me show you where we're going to sit. So this is the troop compartment back here. You'd have about 18, maybe 21 heavily armed Marines. This is going to be my spot right here. Scotty would sit across from me with a camera. Good news is I'm right up against the engine, a little more protection that way. The bad news, this stuff, this is all the ammunition.
You can see the bullet hole right here where a 9mm slug hit. And here's the bullet itself, which I think Joel's going to hold on to. The problem with these checkpoints is they disappear. They set up a couple of rocks, they have guns, and they will shoot at you. We got through one. I don't know how many more are going to be ahead. There might be a dozen. And is the story worth it? That's my question.
And of course, afterward, there were many stories to tell.
I remember watching on a number of nights when you were experiencing fire. You guys were under fire.
Yeah, and that is frightening.
That's chilling.
But we were watching some of the video of you standing with fire going around you, and unlike the troops, you're not armed.
No.
Fox's correspondents Rick Leventhal and Greg Kelly were also in the thick of dangerous fighting. And Kelly, the son of New York Police Chief Ray Kelly, despite being wounded in the face by flying shrapnel, kept on reporting.
For now, Ray Kelly.
Here, the show Inside Edition, which would normally be covering the drama of other reality shows, describes reporters with language normally reserved for soldiers.
Among the standouts embedded with the troops was NBC's David Bloom, the 39-year-old anchor of Weekend Today, who had rolled through the desert in his vehicle's cramped quarters and paid the ultimate price for his hard work. On April 6th, he suddenly collapsed and died of a blood clot.
Who can forget those lively reports? They were just classic and beautiful. He's going to be missed.
Reporters paying the ultimate price? And with a blood clot? It's true that Iraq proved to be dangerous for reporters, particularly those unembedded. But what is especially noteworthy here is the focus on the drama of embedding civilians in the military. To see what happens to our favorite characters. To wonder what it must be like to be under such stressful circumstances. To ride along and fantasize about how we might react in their shoes. This is, after all, what good reality TV does. To meet the newfound public demand for the reality TV war, the military went on air with its Pentagon channel in May 2004.
We're going to be covering a lot of different stories today, from the special relationship between NASCAR and the military.
In December, Nightline would do a special called On the Hunt, where reporters tagged along with Task Force Red Dog in Afghanistan.
This is a war story and a love story and a recruiting poster all wrapped into one. This film is a co-production between Nightline and the Discovery Network. On January 10th, Discovery will be launching its new military channel. The Discovery film, Task Force Red Dog, will launch that channel.
As advertised, the military channel launched in January of 2005, streaming the reality TV war 24 hours a day.
24 hours a day, 7 days a week, no matter what type of weather, we'll be there.
Starting Sunday, we're showcasing our finest shows.
You name it, we've got it.
Engaging you every night with the best of the best.
That's one of the coolest things I've ever seen.
So, a concern that came up today, which I thought was an interesting one, one of the problems with this is that it becomes almost the ultimate reality TV, and you can forget, I mean, you take the scenes of these vehicles racing across the desert, and you add in the fancy graphics and maps and this and that, and you can, if you're not careful, it's true at this end, and I worry it's also true at the other end, you can lose sight of the fact that this is no game and this is no TV show. This is war.
Chuck, that's right. I'm here at kind of a local gathering place for folks in Blair County, Zacks. And on a normal night, most of these television sets at this local establishment would be tuned to those sporting events, the basketball games and the hockey games that are underway right now. But a little after 9 o'clock, most, if not all, of the sets, including the surround sound, had turned to the war on Iraq. And during an informal poll that I just took a few minutes ago here at Zacks, most of the people that I spoke with have said that the action was decisive. They back our president.
When the Iraq war took to the television, it substituted itself for the normal sporting events. This required only a click of the remote control and the smallest of mental adjustments. Audiences naturally shifted from one event to the other.
Time now for a quick update of the NCAA tournament.
And Larry Smith joins us with more.
Certainly the war affecting viewing habits this time of year.
Is it?
NCAA tournament TV ratings down because of the war with Iraq.
The basketball tournament and the war merged so completely in 2003 that the NCAA president had his own fighting words for Saddam Hussein.
In our plans, we were not going to let a tyrant determine how we will lead our lives.
But basketball wasn't the only sport to realize there was another game in town.
Of Super Bowl 37, brought to you by...
Football naturally militarized itself as well. 2 months before the invasion of Iraq, the Navy supplied a destroyer, the USS Preble, to ABC. The ship became the stage for the announcers of Super Bowl 37.
Thank you, and apologies to the true commander of the USS Preble, Timothy Batchelor, who will join us maybe a little bit later on. You know, fans around the country, and we have a lot of fans here of teams that aren't in the Super Bowl.
The signs of an approaching military venture wove themselves into the opening ceremonies of the game.
The anthem will be followed by a Super Hornets flyover by the VFA-122 Flying Eagles from Naval Air Station Lemoore. Ladies and gentlemen, Grammy Award winners, the Dixie Chicks.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proud.
The programming surrounding the Super Bowl also took on military themes, further tying the symbols of sports with the symbols of war.
Pro football and the National Football League and the military have always been tied together. More than 1,200 pro football players either interrupted their careers or postponed them to fulfill their military obligation first.
If we wonder who is promoting such connections, we don't have to look any further than the Pentagon, which sponsored a pregame show called Howie Long's Tough Guys. Hosted by the former linebacker, the show was a combined effort between the Pentagon, the Ford Motor Company, and the NFL. A synergistic infomercial for them all.
Pretty impressive, huh? Welcome to Howie Long's Tough Guys. No, I'm not the captain. That would be Captain Urtesy. I'm, well, you know who I am.
Armed with his Ford truck and store of one-liners, Long cruised America in search of tough guys.
Okay, time out.
You want to talk air attack? The United States Air Force.
Air Force!
You don't really think you're going to play man-to-man coverage, do you?
I didn't think so.
This guy flat out gets it done. A big reason why the Jets went as far as they did.
Long profiled football players in between visits to each branch of the military and rides in their machines. In the end, Ford gave the truck away to the winning tough guy.
I'd like to thank the Department of Defense and everyone who made tough guys possible. I'm Howie Long. Stay tough.
Since the timing of the 2003 invasion of Iraq could be controlled, it had its own pregame show. Just 2 weeks before Shock and Awe, MSNBC aired a Gulf War I retrospective called Waging War, General Schwarzkopf's Diary.
It's a frightening thought.
James Baker, who was Secretary of State under George Bush Sr., describes exactly how we've come to regard the television war.
And I remember going back to my office at the State Department and ordering up a drink, sitting there at 7 or 8 or 9 o'clock at night, I can't remember what time it was, with the television on, to watch the war start. And I thought to myself, this is incredible. And I was going to watch it unfold on television. And I turned on the TV, and the war was late starting. I thought
this pregame show had no shortage of sports metaphors.
When I looked at the disposition of the Iraqi forces prior to the kickoff of the campaign, I
was eager to get out and do it, so it's really almost like the before a big game, you know.
When Waging War returns,
A violent surprise from Saddam.
The new war was shaping up to be a replaying of an old rivalry.
We think their generals were just scared to death.
As the 2003 invasion approached, the language of sports took a naturally prominent place in the coverage.
Just a spectacular day here in San Diego, and as the world waits for the Super Bowl here, there's worlds changing here.
Certainly, you know, there is a sense that the game is on.
This is not by any means the start of the campaign. Well, it's sort of like the coin toss of a football game.
And clearly, I don't think the kickoff was intended to be this target of opportunity.
That one of the missiles landed within one football field of Camp Commando.
If they move in a direction, would be right out there in front. It would sort of be the blockers on a football team, as it were.
And you can see in the studio, for example, the term chalk talk applied just as easily to the general as the coach.
Chuck, give us the chalk talk.
Absolutely, Brian. Let's jump right to the screenwriter because there's been...
Banter about favorite teams also fit right into the coverage.
How about them dogs?
How about them dogs?
The Knicks lost again. Season over, just so you know. I didn't use most of the tickets because of the war, Rick. And then tonight, the Yankees lose 7-6 to Toronto up at the stadium, which was only their second loss of the year. It was a great game, outstanding game. It seemed like every batter went to a full count.
Apart from the spectator sport quality of war coverage, the U.S. military radically shifted recruiting strategies in 2001. For example, both the Army and Navy began sponsoring NASCAR teams. The new ad campaigns took advantage of the language and imagery of sports. Other ad campaigns seem to equate war with a leisure time activity. The Army of One campaign in particular appealed to the new culture of extreme sports.
Even though I'm a part of the strongest army in the world, I am my own force.
In basic training, I'm looking forward to the obstacle course. I think that's going to be really fun.
Your duty today is personal courage.
Biggest fear is climbing down. Like a scary thing for me.
The ad makers for the Marines got on board with extreme sports as well.
The passage is intense.
Indeed, the U.S. military seemed to be taking a scene out of the Vin Diesel spy movie, Triple X. The metaphor of war as spectator sport has powerful implications. The metaphor naturalizes violent conflict, framing it as just another channel of entertainment. This quip from The Daily Show captures the prevalence and power of the spectator sport metaphor.
Americans we're a passionate people. We're a nationalistic people. We can get into those kinds of rivalries as well.
Yeah, but Americans don't need a metaphor for war. We have war. If anything, we use war as a metaphor for sports.
No, it would have been their third. That was their third loss.
Correct.
Still, yeah, the Bo Sox fan in the ceiling needs to just get over himself. Anyway, that's about all the sports I have for you. I guess you saw the final round of the Masters, right?
Presidential address to the nation. From CBS News headquarters in New York, here is Dan Rather.
Good evening. President Bush is about to address the nation from the flight deck of the Navy aircraft carrier USS Abraham Lincoln.
Dan, this flight deck will be the backdrop for the president's speech tonight, in which he will announce an end to major combat operations in Iraq.
After President Bush made instant history aboard an aircraft carrier, Blue Box Toys began producing a presidential action figure as part of their Elite Force collection. KB Toy Stores found it to be a bestseller. After all, like any big Hollywood production, the Iraq War movie demanded merchandise. By all accounts, this was the first time a sitting president had been marketed as an action figure without a trace of irony. The TV war generated an onslaught of other merchandise too, like military monopoly, a series of Topps trading cards, playing cards based on those issued to troops, and other collectibles. For unknown reasons, military bears became a favorite, resulting in some strange combinations. The Hamilton Collection released a military figurine in its line of Faithful Fuzzies. With M16, this bear struck a pose somewhere between unconditional love and unstoppable killing machine. Another toy maker hit upon the idea of the popular Shock and Awe Twin Bear set. Notice their lovingly embroidered names. Recognizing the new absurd levels of war bear mania in 2003, one manufacturer released a satirical bear with a t-shirt that read, "Give us your oil or we will kill you." But war bears didn't hold a candle to the skyrocketing sales of action figures, especially during the Christmas and Easter seasons leading up to the Iraq invasion.
Overall, the toy industry is a $20 billion business, and sales of action figures have gone up about five times just as preparations for the war began. But children only form part of the market. 40 to 60% of sales of action figures come from teenagers and the older adult male consumer.
This time, they were not your average toy soldiers. This new breed of action figure took its cues directly from the television war.
This is currently a figure that we've worked on that'll be available toward the fall of the year all around our troops that are currently fighting in the Middle East.
One toy producer summarized this new trend. "We started working when the showdown buzzword hit the airwaves. There's fierce competition between manufacturers to get the new things out first." Beyond startup companies capitalizing on the war, old standards like G.I. Joe began producing realistic desert-themed sets of U.S. and Israeli soldiers.
G.I. Joe's having a very good year, but G.I. Joe is doing very well, primarily because it's been remarketed to kids.
The association between toys and the TV war was perhaps most vividly captured in an Easter 2003 bestseller, Ever Sparkle's Military Forward Command Post, what amounted to a bombed-out dollhouse. The absurdity of this playset could not escape comment on The Daily Show.
"And it's a good thing. I gotta tell you, I love this. Come on. This is like the Malibu Dream House reimagined after a carpet bombing somewhere in, like, Afghanistan or something." "We happen to have the War Widow Barbie. Now, this is great because your daughter will experience a secret garden of grief. This beauty comes with little handkerchiefs."
The Army eventually caught wind of the success of action figures and began to produce its own in 2006. The Real Heroes series took the war toy to another level. Not only were the toys based on the ongoing occupation of Iraq, they depicted actual soldiers who had served there. This new breed of war toy not only showed up on the consumer market, it showed up on TV. While anchors and guests played their own game of military monopoly on the floor, model planes ringed the set. Lester Holt stopped just short of flying a model plane around the studio. The feedback loop between the TV war and war toys closed completely in a bizarre 2005 incident. An Iraqi insurgent website posted a picture of an apparent captured U.S. soldier. The website identified the captive as John Adam. After some time, officials discovered that it was instead a close-up of an action figure named Cody, complete with a toy M16 held to his head.
"But no American soldiers had been reported missing, and an American toy maker noticed that the soldier was a ringer for its special ops action figure, Cody."
When news coverage began to affect the action on the ground in the first Gulf War, the phenomenon was dubbed the CNN effect. Perhaps this was the beginning of the G.I. Joe effect.
Communications, satellite systems, and unmanned drones backing up the ground troops as never before, allowing commanders to watch a battlefield hundreds of miles away in real time.
It's like we fought the war in 1991 in the DOS era, in the paper era, and now we're fighting wars in the Windows era.
The new virtual war has not only engendered new methods of state violence, but also new relationships between civil and military spheres. In 1997, for example, the Marines began using modifications of commercial games to train foot soldiers. The first of these was Marine Doom, a modification of the popular first-person shooter. The Army made use of Tom Clancy's Rogue Spear. The Navy commissioned Fleet Command. And the British military began using Half-Life. But games crossed the boundary in the other direction too, from military to commercial markets. In 1994, Sega Game Systems coaxed military contractor Martin Marietta to commercially release a simulator used to train tank operators. The result was the game Desert Tank. The next year, the game company Digital Integration sought to release another training simulator, this one developed by military contractor McDonnell Douglas for flying Apache helicopters. The game hit the market in 1995 as Apache Longbow. The first Gulf War had made a television star out of the Apache, and naturally the public was eager to test drive it. What better way to do this than with a real training simulator? But this was not the end of what some were beginning to call at this time the military Nintendo complex. In 1997, defense contractor OC Inc. developed a simulator to train military leadership. Civilian game makers Rival Interactive saw commercial potential in the simulator and sponsored its release under the name Real War. In a bizarre coincidence, Real War was set to be released on September 11, 2001, but was pushed back to the 27th due to the attacks. In 2003, commercial game makers THQ released a foot soldier trainer used by the Army called Full Spectrum Warrior. Like Real War, the fact that the game had been an actual military training simulator was an obvious selling point.
Top 10 games of 2004, states PC Gamer. The most authentic military gaming experience. Quantum Leap Forward in Battlefield Simulation, states Game Informer.
The game company Destineer followed suit in 2005 by releasing a marine combat simulator called Close Combat First to Fight.
Folks in Iraq are seeing the symbols of Saddam Hussein come tumbling down. Now Americans are finding their own way to vent against the Iraqi dictator. Folks right here in the U.S. shooting paintballs at pictures of the Iraqi dictator. In Indiana, people are playing war games, pretending to be soldiers searching for him.
The main feature of this new video game war is an interactive urge.
Kelly Arena has her finger on the button. She'll literally blow up a truck to show us the explosive situations U.S. troops often face in Iraq and Afghanistan.
Push it.
Recognizing these new trends, the Pentagon naturally sought to capitalize on the new public appetite for war play. The Air Force began releasing recruitment ads whose main enticement was that someday we might be handed the controller. The image of crossing over is a useful way to understand the new culture of war games. These games routinely invite us to cross over and play virtual soldier in an increasingly militarized civil culture.
45-year-old Lieutenant Colonel Casey Wardinsky is in charge of Army manpower. He's also the economist who came up with the idea of using a video game as a recruiting tool while brainstorming with entertainment executives in Los Angeles.
I was trying to work through the economics of all this, and I was chatting with a friend at a cocktail party. He was in direct marketing, and he pointed out how cheap it is to put like a videotape or a DVD in a house. And that really struck me as amazingly a sort of affordable way of doing business. And then the next thing was, well, why can't we put something more immersive in a house beyond a DVD or a tape, like a game? And then, voila, it looked like it was doable.
Nowhere is the militarization of culture more pronounced than with the Army's newest weapon in its recruiting arsenal, a video game called America's Army. The Army released the free game in 2001. Since then, it has been a runaway success, with over 6 million registered users in 2005. America's Army introduced an entirely new relationship between the military and popular culture. This is not just any old war game. America's Army comes with a stamp of authenticity. The game's very existence advances the notion that war can be a form of entertainment, a leisure time activity. This sense was enhanced when the Army released a version of the game called Real Heroes. This game featured playable characters based on actual soldiers who had served in Iraq and elsewhere. With America's Army, the military had indeed conquered a new frontier.
You're in, darling. You're in our mind.
I found it interesting when folks say we're softening them up. We're not softening them up, we're killing them.
So this is no video game, this is war. Defense officials tell Fox...
These kinds of expressions date back to the first Gulf War. In 1991, Commanding General Norman Schwarzkopf told the press that war was not a Nintendo game. The need to say this, of course, signals the fact that war has come to look very much like a video game. As viewers of the TV war, we are treated to endless flyovers. We are immersed in a general spirit of play. We are shown countless computer animations that contribute to a sense of virtuality. We play alongside news anchors who watch on their monitors. We sit in front of the crosshairs directing missiles with a sense of interactivity. The destruction, if shown at all, seems unreal, distant. These repeated images foster habitual fantasies of crossing over.
Mike Herbert remembers watching missiles like this one crash into targets on TV during Desert Storm. He was only a teenager.
And to actually do that myself for the first time, when I remember in high school seeing it on TV, on being able to see that, now to actually do it, it's a whole different world.
So it is no surprise when the metaphor of the video game makes its inevitable appearance in debates regarding journalism and war.
But if there's a war that's a Nintendo war, it was this one. We were basically playing some sort, almost a real virtual reality
game. Right,
except
now we're up at PlayStation 2 values.
Yeah, we were there.
That is it for the panel today. Douglas Rushkoff, thanks. Eduardo Braniff and Elizabeth.
On this video game point, because Sony has already copyrighted the words shock and awe. They've got a video game coming out called exactly this.
Indeed, 30-odd companies eventually trademarked the phrase shock and awe. PlayStation manufacturer Sony was the largest of these, applying for its patent only one day after the spectacular bombing of Baghdad. Sony dropped the trademark a month later under threat of controversy. But this did not stop other game manufacturers from capitalizing on the war. Gotham Games aggressively advertised its Gulf War I-based game, Conflict Desert Storm, during the lead-up to the invasion. The company then went into full-scale production of the sequel, Conflict Desert Storm 2, Back to Baghdad. The game arrived in stores just 6 months after the 2003 invasion, and still during the violent occupation. This time around, it appeared as though war games might catch up with the war itself. In 2004, a group of military retirees formed a game company to do just that. The result was the online subscription game, Kuma War. The game at first appeared to be an average first-person shooter, but the minds behind Kuma War had bigger plans. CEO Keith Halper made these intentions clear. What we are trying to do is be a news organization.
From the headlines,
to the front lines. We put you there.
The game reconstructs television war events so that they can be played in 3D just days after they air. These missions have included the killing of Saddam Hussein's two sons, Uday and Qusay, and a raid on Fallujah, an insurgent stronghold.
Real World Games. Subscribe to Kuma War, and each month you'll get playable missions delivered to your computer. Intense episodic play based on the very same stories rocking the world today.
Players are briefed before the mission with actual news clippings, words of advice from real military officers, and encouragement from game programmers.
After we report it, you play it in single player and multiplayer. You devise the tactics. You make the hard choices.
Kuma War illustrates the logical direction of embedded war coverage. In a sense, the game provides an embeddedness even the reporter cannot offer.
You are the 4th Infantry Division capturing Saddam. You are the 10th Mountain Division hunting Al-Qaeda in Afghanistan. Wherever the war takes our forces, we'll put you there.
Hello and welcome. I'm Jackie Schechner and this is Kuma War. When four U.S. civilian contractors were murdered and their bodies publicly mutilated in Fallujah last March, U.S. Marines...
Kuma War goes out of its way to take on the visual cues of television news. This game demo purportedly features real Marines playing Kuma War characters. Notice the 24-hour news channel type crawl at the bottom of the screen. The camera following these troops is, of course, the Kuma embedded reporter. War games have always been with us in some form, but what is new is that games are merging with TV news and real-world events in unprecedented ways. If it is true that games have caught up with the wars themselves, what does it mean that Kuma War has designed a game involving the U.S. invasion of Iran even before the event?
This right here, our first picture, is of Stephanie Antipinti. She is with, the heavy picture. She's with the 173rd Airborne in northern Iraq, and her father says that he is very proud of his daughter and the troops, and he wants Stephanie to know that even though he is not in Iraq, to comfort her, that God will protect her and keep her safe.
This right here. Perhaps the biggest roadblock to an otherwise smooth-running TV war is the visibility of domestic dissent. Initial dissent often comes from those making the biggest sacrifices, the families of military men and women. In fact, it was this kind of dissent that accounted for the so-called Vietnam Syndrome. Because dissent was largely viewed by policymakers as a kind of national disease, a massive dose of therapy was in order. Beginning in the first Gulf War, a dominant story has been one of exemplary families who have learned to channel their anxiety toward coping.
And we'll take you live to Fort Stewart, Georgia, to meet a sergeant with the 3rd Infantry Division. How are families coping as that unit gets ready to deploy?
In this new year, there's now a new reality. Duty calls again.
This is different than all the other times because you don't know when you're coming home.
What many of these families say they do know is this. This mission and their sacrifice is worth it.
If they don't solve it now, it's just going to get worse, and I'd rather make it safe for kids to grow up now than, you know, not knowing.
Apart from the example of coping families, this therapeutic message can be heard in a variety of contexts.
Just be a proud mom and not a nervous mom. I love you all very much. Please be safe and don't worry about me. I'm happy to be where I am. This is my contribution.
Hidden from view amidst these therapeutic messages are not only the dead and wounded, but also military families who find the war to be unjustified. The organization Military Families Speak Out, for example, represented over 3,000 such families in 2003. But these stories of dissent are deemed not fit for a screen filled with coping families and happy homecomings. Not only are we given ways to cope, but also a few stern warnings. We are told that families who want their sons and daughters to be brought home could, in reality, be the ones putting them in danger.
My son's letter is just one example of many of how opposition at this point hurts their morale.
The Cranes believe anti-war sentiment at home is a constitutional right, but
I would ask, first of all, that they be mindful of the consequence, because it may be my son's or any of the other soldiers' death.
In this way, supporting the troops is made synonymous with supporting the war. Those who disagree with the decision to send soldiers to war are thus identified with the enemy. This is done through a variety of associations.
The pictures tell a disturbing story. On the eve of possible war with Iraq, it appears that anti-American sentiment is...
Worldwide, protesters are characterized as anti-U.S., or in this case, pro-Saddam.
Many with anti-U.S. posters in English. In Jordan, police clashed with pro-Saddam demonstrators in Amman, the capital. And in Gaza, large anti-U.S. protests today, despite President Bush's new calls for a Palestinian state.
On February 15, 2003, 14 million people in 600 cities took to the streets in the largest day of protest in world history. The event was largely invisible on the news in the U.S. When it did appear, CNN associated the event with a march organized by Saddam Hussein.
A million people took to the streets of Rome as hundreds of thousands more turned out in other capitals across Europe. Meanwhile, in Baghdad, Iraqi officials presided over a demonstration in support of Saddam Hussein. In separate rallies,
instead of an entity advocating peaceful alternatives, demonstrators are woven into the dominant story of conflict. The war abroad is thus extended to a war on protesters at home. This framing of dissent makes the most sense in combination with images of protester violence, the preferred television image of dissent. Any peaceful message appears secondary to the dominant story of conflict, if it appears at all.
San Francisco's protests turned violent last night as marchers hurled rocks and bottles at police.
Everybody clear to the sidewalk now.
And as the day's largest anti-war protest in the United States continued in New York, multiple arrests were made as protesters refused to go home.
In this framing, police are to protesters as soldiers are to the enemy. Dissent thus becomes synonymous with criminal activity.
This one hauled off by his hair, shouting anti-war outrage all the way to the slammer.
Images of long-haired shrieking protesters fit the narrative of criminality best. And the implication is that this anger, this deviant rage, is directed at the troops fighting abroad.
Our boys are over in Iraq, and they see this, and it brings the morale down. I think the morale has to be up.
Let's talk about the ones here in the United States. Are they going to encourage Saddam Hussein to fight harder? Are they encourage his own people to fight harder? Joe, what are the exact consequences? Oh. Go through them.
Let me tell you something. Saddam
Run through
Hussein,
them.
I'm running through them. Saddam Hussein is being helped by the protesters on the streets here and in Europe.
This framing divides the world into two. The president, troops, and supporters of the war on one side, and on the other side, Saddam Hussein, protesters, and other criminals.
Thanks, Grant. Her son's fighting in the war overseas, and tonight a mother in Brooklyn is fighting her own war in her neighborhood against vandals. Marvin Scott is live tonight on Park Slope with more on this. Marvin.
This repeated framing of dissent sometimes provokes some strange responses.
One guy in Portland, Oregon, burning a peace flag. He says he supports the U.S. war with Iraq to oust Saddam Hussein. This is his answer to war protesters in Portland.
Beyond criminalization, images of dissent, if aired at all, are diffused in other ways. Here, CNN's Aaron Brown feels the need to apologize for showing pictures of demonstrators. Dissent is a byproduct of democracy, we're told, and something we must suffer through on the way to war.
The American democracy. You are allowed to take to the streets to show your displeasure, even in times like this. This is part of what we go through, and as long as it stays peaceful.
But if dissent is to be tolerated, it is portrayed as an empty exercise. If therapeutic messages can't keep protesters off the streets, perhaps protesting itself can be a way to blow off steam.
Now psychologists are discovering that protesting can have a surprising effect on a child's health. Lisa Stofko has more. It's in tonight's Connect with Kids.
A new study out of Britain shows protesting in general can improve a person's mental and physical well-being. Protests that are peaceful can actually improve a person's mental and even physical health. It doesn't seem to matter what your child is protesting for or against. Just being involved can reduce stress, anxiety, and depression.
It makes you feel like you're making a difference. I feel that I'm empowered because...
In some places, dissent is reduced to an adolescent temper tantrum or an extracurricular activity. In others, dissent is trivialized as a vain ploy for attention, as in the metaphor of the fashion statement.
Today's fashion statement on Fifth, plastic handcuffs, more than 150 arrests.
If dissent is nothing more than childish vanity, the next logical question is whether dissent matters at all. Television news spent a good deal of time posing this question.
Anti-war protests are the email topic of the day. We want to know your thoughts on this. Are they effective in changing public policy? Or do you think they send the wrong signal to U.S. troops overseas?
The people united will never be defeated!
But is America really listening?
After the 2003 invasion, television news apparently decided that the answer to this question was no. Saddam had lost the war, and so had the protesters along with him.
Despite ongoing rhetoric, anti-war protesters are decreasing in numbers and increasingly frustrated. The war they call unjust is just about done and has gone much more smoothly than they predicted.
If protesters had been irrelevant before the invasion, they were deemed absurd after it, even as early as April of 2003, during the beginnings of the long occupation of Iraq.
What's an anti-war demonstrator to do? Well, for some peace activists, the answer seems to be find a new target. But are they hurting their own cause? Trace Gallagher reports. You decide.
Having failed at stopping the liberation of Iraq, anti-war groups are now trying to get people to oppose the president, oppose funding for the recovery of Iraq, and oppose the cultural impact of American fast food.
Well, it's been 25 days since the war in Iraq began, and 4 days ago only that we all watched that statue of Saddam Hussein coming down in Baghdad. The Iraqi regime has collapsed. Those people who said it would be short and successful, at least in the military phase, have proven to be right. And yet this weekend, in more than 50 countries overseas and here, there were people still demonstrating against the war. So we asked ABC's Judy Muller to take a closer look at why.
Actors and actresses have to watch out now because there's a war on, and if you say the wrong thing, it could be held against you.
Nobody knows that better than the Dixie Chicks, who continue to suffer the backlash from lead singer Natalie Maine's anti-Bush comments.
If the voice of the masses was irrelevant, especially so were the voices of those who had an audience, celebrities and other high-profile figures.
Put on your seatbelts, we're in for a ride. It's the Dennis Prager Show.
Radio talk show host Dennis Prager says stars are under the misguided impression they speak for everyday Americans.
The idea that someone who has acted now has a claim on my respect for his or her opinions on the great moral issues of the day is absurd.
Still, the barrage of ads goes on.
Don't invade Iraq. Inspections work. War won't.
The new rule? Celebrities with their own talk show, like Dennis Prager or Michael Savage, could have legitimate views. Celebrities who dissented could not.
And Martin Sheen says it's not for his humanity to free these people.
Okay.
Do you remember all the Hollywood idiots who said we shouldn't liberate the people? Why not? This was okay to them? This was good. This is what was going on.
Dissent on any visible level was associated with Hollywood phoniness.
In fact, you should be an actor because you sound just like one. To call the president stupid, he doesn't know much about anything, that's just great. Go with Danny Glover and Susan Sarandon. You fit in perfectly.
Yeah, you know those crazy.
If a dissenting voice did happen to have press credentials, such as Helen Thomas, the oldest member of the White House press corps, she would have to be elevated to the status of celebrity first before her views were trivialized.
That may have cost her the kind of first-row seniority she's enjoyed in Washington for decades.
Not calling on Helen Thomas at a press conference is like a field trip to Washington when you don't go to the Washington Monument.
Thomas called last night's news conference scripted. She said the president had a list of names to call on. And she charges the president was afraid to call on her. If that's true, we can say goodbye to classic scenes like this.
And I have a follow-up.
Thank you for warning me.
The White House responds by saying that...
As with street protest, if high-profile dissent could not be contained, perhaps it could be neutralized with a now familiar question.
Celebrity opinion in the debate over a possible war has spawned a second debate on the streets, whether star power has any real power to shape public opinion.
A recent poll says no. More than 90% of those surveyed say celebrity activism does not affect their political opinions. This website created by a North Carolina mom is called Citizens Against Celebrity Pundits. It's received more than 60,000 cyber signatures from people who want celebrities to shut up.
If taken seriously, the dominant framing of dissent spans the field, rendering practically all critical voices illegitimate. When an entire range of voices is silenced, either criminalized or trivialized, then real democracy has given way to a version of authoritarianism.
This war is obviously underway, Aaron, and it's going to get a lot more intense.
The formula remains the same.